Hello students! If you want to know how heat moves around, you need to understand thermodynamics. Thermodynamics, is a branch of physics studying the relationship between heat, work, temperature, and energy. Thermodynamics forms the basis for your house's central heating and refrigerator and the engines that move your car. Thermodynamics shows us how to use energy efficiently.
Our goal today is to learn some basic concepts in thermodynamics. It is important to understand rather than simply memorize them. The energy contained in a hot cup of coffee is thermal energy, Lampenergia. The thermal energy of an object is the energy contained in the motion and vibration of its molecules. A boiling cup of coffee has very active water molecules moving around very quickly. Thermal energy is contained within an object and is responsible for its temperature. The hotter an object is, the more thermal energy it has. Microwave heating of foods results from conversion of electromagnetic energy to thermal energy. In our previous lesson, we discussed the electromagnetic spectrum. Microwave radiation lies close to radio frequency radiation in the electromagnetic spectrum. Microwave ovens produce waves that are just the right frequency to cause molecules in water flip around faster and faster. So, the water molecules in food absorb microwave radiation, which increases their motions. This energy is then transferred to other types of molecules via collisions, causing an increase in the food's temperature. In everyday terms, the temperature, Lämpötila, is an indication of how hot or cold something is. In science, temperature is a measure of the average kinetic energy of the particles that make up all matter. In Finland, like in most countries around the world, people use the metric unit of temperature, which is degrees Celsius. The Celsius scale sets the freezing point of water at 0 degrees Celsius and the boiling point of water at 100 degrees Celsius. The SI unit for temperature is the Kelvin. In science, temperature is measured on the Kelvin scale. The Kelvin scale avoids negative temperatures by assigning 0 Kelvin, minus 273 degrees Celsius, to the coldest temperature possible, absolute zero. Absolute zero is the temperature at which molecular motion stops. Lower temperatures do not exist. The size of the Kelvin is identical to that of the Celsius degree. The only difference is the temperature that each designates as zero. Conversion between these two scales simply requires an adjustment for the different zero points. For converting Kelvin to Celsius, simply subtract 273. The conversion to Kelvin is remarkably easy. Add 273 to your Celsius temperature. Heat, lamp, is the flow of thermal energy between two objects. Heat refers to a quantity transferred between systems, not to a property of any one system. The temperature of two objects acts as a signpost showing the direction in which energy will flow as heat. Heat always flows from high temperature to low temperature. Heat transfer of energy from hot to cold is related to the tendency in nature for systems to always move toward more disorder, or in physics terms, entropy. Heat cannot transfer energy spontaneously from colder to hotter. Heat can be transferred from a cold body to the hot one if it is forced to pass to higher temperature by applying an external drive, that means by doing some form of work on the system. Both the refrigerator and the air conditioner do work to overcome the rule that heat can never flow from a cooler zone to a hotter one. That's the reason they require electricity to function. Notice that your fridge does not add cold to your food. It takes heat away. Heat can be transferred by conduction, by convection, and by radiation. Heat transfer through radiation takes place in form of electromagnetic waves. Thermal radiation is emitted by all objects above absolute zero. At room temperature, most of the emission is in the infrared spectrum. A thermographic camera, lamp camera, creates an image using infrared radiation. Conduction is the transfer of heat through physical contact. Metals are good thermal conductors. Convection is the transfer of heat from one place to another due to the physical movement of fluid. Convection is the dominant form of heat transfer in liquids and gases. Despite their English name, radiators, lamp batteries, mostly work through convection. Yes, radiation and conduction are also involved in heating, but heat is mainly spread by convection. Convection currents are created when the air above the radiator is warmed. It expands, becomes less dense, and rises, and is replaced by the cooler, denser air which surrounds it. In this way, the circulating movement is caused by differences in air temperature and pressure. A hot water radiator consists of a sealed, hollow metal container filled with hot water. Water is a typical heat transfer fluid in many different applications. Heat transfer fluids must have a high heat capacity. Specific heat capacity, ominaislämpö, kapasiteetti, is the heat required to raise the temperature of the unit mass of a given substance by 1 degree. This depends largely on the substance's molecular structure and the freedom of its particles to vibrate and move. It takes nearly 5 times as much energy to raise the temperature of water by 1 degree Celsius as it does to heat aluminium the same amount. In fact, water has the highest specific heat capacity of any common substance. Changing its temperature requires a lot of heat. If you have ever experienced the drop in temperature that occurs when traveling from an inland region to the coast during summer, you have experienced the effects of water's specific heat capacity. Water absorbs much of the sun's heat without undergoing a large increase in temperature. That's why oceanic and Mediterranean climates are characterized by narrow temperature ranges. As soil and rock have a much lower heat capacity than water, they gain and lose heat quickly. That's why continental climates have a significant annual variation in temperature, hot summers and cold winters. Most of the human body is water. with an average of roughly 60%, and our delicate brains are about 80% water. The high specific heat of water provides us excellent protection against sudden spikes in ambient temperature. Adding heat does not always increase the temperature at all. When you heat ice, its temperature rises, but as soon as the ice starts to melt, the temperature stays constant until all the ice has melted. All the heat energy added to the ice is absorbed by water molecules changing phases. The same thing happens when you heat water to the boiling point. The water will heat until the temperature 100 degrees Celsius, but when water is boiling, adding heat does not increase its temperature. At the boiling temperature, adding heat energy converts the liquid into a gas without raising the temperature. The amount of thermal energy in particles of matter determines the state of matter. In solid matter, atoms or molecules pack close to each other and do not move around or past each other. In liquids, atoms or molecules move more freely than in solids, sliding past one another. In gaseous matter, atoms or molecules are free to move. Even though an ice cube is solid, the water molecules have thermal energy which causes each one to vibrate about a fixed point. The motion is much less than in a liquid, but significant nonetheless. What happens at the molecular level as we increase our ice cube's temperature? The increasing thermal energy causes water molecules to vibrate faster and faster. At the melting point, 0 degrees Celsius in case of ice, the molecules have enough thermal energy to overcome the forces that hold them at their stationary points, and the solid turns into a liquid. This process is called melting or fusion, sulaminen in Finnish. Now we have water molecules within a glass of water sitting on a table at room temperature. Some molecules have more energy than the average and some have less. The molecules with high enough thermal energy can break free from the surface and into the gas phase. This process is called vaporization, haihtuminen. You probably know from experience that water in a glass may take many days to evaporate completely. What happens if we increase the temperature of water? Vaporization occurs more quickly. And if a liquid reaches its boiling point, 100 degrees Celsius in case of water, the thermal energy is enough for molecules in the interior of the liquid, and not just those at the surface, to break free of their neighbors and enter the gas phase. When matter undergoes a phase change, it is either absorbed or released. Any transition from a more ordered to a less ordered state, solid to liquid, liquid to gas, or solid to gas, requires an input of energy. Conversely, any transition from a less ordered to a more ordered state, liquid to solid, gas to liquid, or gas to solid, releases energy. When you overheat, you sweat. Your skin gets covered with liquid water. As this water evaporates, it absorbs heat from your body, cooling your skin. So it's not sweat that cools you down, it's the evaporation of sweat. Unlike liquids or solids, the particles in gases are moving sufficiently quickly that there is very little influence from the attraction between them. The interatomic forces between gas particles aren't strong enough to hold the atoms in place or prevent them from escaping from each other, so they will spread to fill a container entirely. The constant battering of the particles against a container's walls collectively provides the pressure of the gas. Gases can be compressed, squeezed into a small volume. Because there is so much empty space between atoms or molecules in the gaseous state. So, transitions between the liquid and gas phase can be achieved not only by heating and cooling, but also through changes in pressure. Increasing the pressure of gas results in a transition to the liquid phase. When we compress the gas, pressure increases, which means temperature also increases. And then when we want to cool gas, we just allow it to expand without allowing any heat to enter from outside. The process of cooling gas by expansion through a narrow opening is called the Chul-Thompson effect. This gas cooling process is commonly exploited in refrigeration processes. Heat pumps work by using refrigerant to absorb and release heat energy through a process that pressurizes the gas to heat it up and depressurizes it to cool it down. The refrigerant is the fluid that circulates through the heat pump. In the condenser coil, refrigerant releases heat to its surroundings and becomes a liquid which is circulated to the evaporator coil. In the evaporator coil, the refrigerant absorbs heat from its surroundings and boils to become a low temperature vapor. The compressor then squeezes the molecules of the refrigerant gas together, increasing the temperature of the refrigerant. The compressor requires electricity. Remember, heat flows from hot to cold unless you put energy into the system to force it to go the other way. The electricity input into the heat pump is used to transfer thermal energy to unnatural direction. A fridge, Jagabi, works in the same way. An expanding liquid becomes a cooling gas as the refrigerant fluid vaporizes via change in pressure, absorbing heat from inside the fridge. And the compressor then turns the gas back into a warm liquid. When a refrigerant condenses to a liquid state, it releases heat into the kitchen. A refrigerator warms the air around it when it cools objects within it. So, when a gas is compressed in compressors, work needs to be done. Work flows into the system. On the other hand, expanding gas can do work on the surroundings. Expansion work is the work done when a system expands against an opposing pressure. This is a common type of work associated with chemical processes. For example, in a car engine, the heat from the combustion of the gasoline expands the gases in the cylinder to push back the piston, and this motion is then translated into the motion of the car.
Now take a few moments to go over your notes. Doing this will help you retain the knowledge you've gained from this class. You could also create a mind map to show the relationships between concepts. Goodbye. Nähdään taas.